Then let us begin.
Let us. Hi, I'm Simon Mercer. Welcome to Crave, the podcast webcast dedicated to all manner of entertainment. Although at the moment, Steve McCabe, that entertainment doesn't include, in Auckland anyway, live music and the cinema.
No, it will soon. We'll be back. But in the meantime, you know, we've got all the other myriad pleasures that we've had over the years. And since we're back in lockdown, we're revisiting a lockdown pleasure.
Absolutely. And this, I have to slip this in, Steve. This is the 101st episode of Crave. So this is Crave.
Certainly is.
This is Crave 101 for beginners.
Oh, very good, sir. Very good. I see what you did there.
I had to slip that in. But anyway, as Steve said, this week we are having a look at the return of a worldwide renowned Spanish crime thriller called Money Heist.
Yeah.
It had two seasons previously. It's called in Spanish La Casa de Papel, but it's the English version is Money Heist.
Absolutely, which is a rubbish translation, really, because it's way more than just that.
I think so.
In fact, I'm not even sure they're heisting money this time round. Yeah. And so we're actually technically on the fifth series this time round, because you remember that the first story was two series, and the second story was two series. So now we're actually on series five now. So we've got what you'd expect. We've got the Latin passion. We've got the tension. We've got the violence. We've got the romance. And it sounds a little bit like this.
¿Qué ibas a decir? He ejecutado a una mujer indefensa. Y luego me he vendido y he traicionado a mi bando por cobarde.
Andía, tranquilo.
Hola, Juanito, hijo mío. ¿Sabes qué? Papá es un mierda. ¿Por qué? Porque prefiero ir a que me maten a quedarme contigo y leerte un cuento. ¿Qué vas a hacer?
Capitán, quieto. Capitán, ¿no me oye?
Y dile a mamá.
¡Es una orden, capitán!
Que llegaba siempre tarde porque no me la quería follar.
¡Te estoy hablando, capitán!
So a heady mix indeed, seriously. But the question is, Simon, right? Is it outstaying its welcome, or has it earned its fifth series?
That is the question, which, by the way, is on Netflix, in case we didn't mention that earlier, this at the moment in New Zealand. Well, the answer, that there's two parts to that answer. First of all, they left the end of the previous series hanging.
We
were left with the professor being discovered by this incredible character, this heavily pregnant, deranged police detective called Alicia Sierra.
Oh, yeah.
And so we had to resolve that. So I guess for that reason alone, we had to tidy up that part of the story. Having said that, Steve, the first episode, maybe two, I remember all the guns and the battles and the words flying, and as you said, the passion surging, and I wondered whether initially I thought, oh man, maybe I've just seen too much of this. And I think especially that first episode, there is a lot of catching up with plot. I felt that I wasn't being reintroduced to the characters as much as I would like. It did take me a while to get back into it, but overall, and I have seen all of the this current season that's now on Netflix, by the end of it, I can certainly say I was totally invested, as I'd been once before, thoroughly enjoying it and gripping the edge of my seat, wondering who might or might not join the dearly departed. Because if you've been following before, several key characters have been killed off in the previous seasons. Characters like...
Should we just make a point right now before you go any further?
Yes.
We are expecting that our listener will have seen everything ahead of this, right? There's been four series, and if you've not watched it, seriously, what have you been, like, locked down or something? we're going to avoid spoilers for series five, but series one to four at this point, fair game for spoilers, so you have been warned.
Quite right.
So Steve, as you were saying,
absolutely right. So just to return to that point, Maybe a little bit like Game of Thrones, Steve, where, you know, we're almost used to some of the central grouping of characters perhaps meeting their demise.
Yes.
And we've seen that already in the first four series. We've had Moscow, Nairobi, Oslo, and Berlin all perish. So you are left, as you go through this latest series, just with that question in the back of your mind, who's next?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, they kind of like recap at the very, there's a very brief recap.
Yes.
At the start of the first series, where they all cheer, poor Nairobi, and then...
Yes.
And we all think, yeah, indeed, poor Nairobi. But then we move on. Then it does move on. That's it. That's the extent of the recap. And if you remember, series four was bonkers. It covered an awful lot of very, very scattershot territory, if you remember. Yeah. And so this is my issue with it.
Right.
Let's be clear about this. The first story, series one and two, perfect. Pretty much flawless television, right? I watched it with our intrepid reporter, Debbie. Yes. And they would start each episode with Wednesday, 1760, 43 p.m. And you think, they've only moved on an hour since they started the heist. The time moved along so... I mean, each episode trotted past really quickly, but the time was stretched, and it was magnificently done because they spent ages developing the interplay between the characters. You understood everything about them, what they were doing, why they were doing it. It was very delicately done, and the tension was allowed to simmer. There was possibly one or two little things I thought were slight missteps, but overall it was flawless. But then the second story, series three and four, somebody said, well, if folk like the explosions, we better get a few more explosions in there, hadn't we? And suddenly it became almost like a comic.
I agree with you on that. It is, some of the violence now is like comic book violence. I agree with that. The second story arc, which was series three, yes, and series four,
yeah,
that didn't quite do it for you.
Not as much. I mean, there's a certain extent to which I watched it out of loyalty. I mean, it was still a great fun ride.
Yes.
But characters like, as you say, Alicia Silvera are spectacularly barking. She's a magnificent presence, and the places they take her in series five are even more astonishing. Yeah. But it wasn't. I think if that's the first I'd seen, if I hadn't seen the first story, if I hadn't seen series one and two, I don't think I would have had half the affection for this show or the characters.
I agree with that. I think in the end, you're not really watching it for the action and the bullets flying, because bullets flying around after a while can get pretty boring.
Yes.
But what's at stake are the lives of these characters that we've now into five series of getting to know them.
Exactly.
And because it is infused with this surging Latin passion. Conversation is like the world depends on it, and which can be energy sapping and exhausting at times, but... boy, you really are with them in it. And I think one thing I did like about this latest series, and the others did it as well, they do weave timelines in and out and other stories in and out in this latest series, I think, is a way of giving a bit of light and shade. Otherwise, the relentlessness of the gun battles would just be too much and you'd actually switch off, I suspect. So I think some credit to the writers for doing that to reinvest us in the characters and keep us going over several episodes.
I'd agree with that to a certain extent. I mean, we had in episode four, for example, there's a few nice flashbacks to Tokyo and Nairobi.
Yes.
When they are in the monastery sort of preparing for the current heist. And again, it's character development. It's really nicely done. You got two fantastic actresses there who really develop. I mean, they're given a lot to work with and they do a lot with what they're given. And you put that together and you have an amazing piece of TV. But then we've got a whole other sort of side hustle going on with Berlin and his son.
Yes.
Which is very nice and it's very clever. And even like sort of the musical cues tell you they're trying to do sort of like a crime caper, Ocean's Eleven type heist.
Yeah.
And it, and I mean, I've seen four of the five episodes so far. I've not seen the fifth yet. I will assume, I will assume that there's a payoff for all that. Because right now, as you've mentioned, Berlin's not even in the current heist. So so I'm curious to see where the payoff is going to come for that. And spoilers, and you're in trouble.
No, don't worry. What I can say, without fear of spoiling anything, is that just as the previous seasons had been, like two series was one story arc, right?
Yes.
So this latest one, which I guess you could say is season five, as you called it, there will have to be a season six to tidy up this current.
Right.
And I think that's due in December, I think it is. So what we're watching now is the first half.
Right.
The half comes in December. So you are not, this won't spoil it, not every plot strand is going to be tidied up by the time you get to the end of the next episode, Steve.
Good enough.
You will be emotionally wrung out and reaching for, I wouldn't say a handkerchief, but well, maybe it will be a handkerchief or a tissue or some description. Anyway,
excellent.
But one of the things that this also does that all the way through it, Steve, isn't it, is it's not just about crime. The writers are completely into the sort of the social commentary. These guys are like Spanish versions of Robin Hood and his Merry Men.
Yes,
they are robbing, but they are exposing corruption and double dealing in bureaucracy and government and other crime fighting officials who they expose.
Yes.
And part of it is how they are attempting with varying degrees of success to get the public on their side. So that's why one of the reasons why when I saw the, as you said earlier, Steve, that title of this whole extravaganza, Money Heist sounds like a Spanish version maybe of Ocean's 11 or something like that.
Yes.
Because I think it really is, it is diving into sort of a moral tale of corruption and loyalty and all sorts of issues like that. So I think it deserves a better title. I agree with you.
Yeah. And I definitely think a little bit more focus wouldn't be a bad idea. I mean, I watched the first episode the day it came out. And then the next day I watched it again.
Did you?
Because I was about to start watching the second episode. And I was thinking to myself, hang on a second. I'm not sure I really know what's going on here. And partly, I mean, it's been a year, I think, since.
Yes.
Which is fair enough, because these episodes, they're not going to make themselves in an afternoon. There's the one thing we have to say for this show is the production values are astonishingly high.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the level of pyrotechnics they're using is pretty outrageous. So this will have taken a lot of making. So it's been a year. And like you say, we didn't have any kind of closure at the end of the last series. There were characters I'd forgotten about.
Yeah, I agree. In fact, I went a step further, Mr. McCabe, showing true professional dedication to the cause of this illustrious podcast that we work on. I went back and watched all of the final episode of the previous season because I thought, hold on. There are a lot of characters running around here. I just need to reacquaint myself with a few of them. It did help, actually. And especially as when you think, well, there is a reasonable chance that by the end of the season, not all of them will still be with us.
Right.
So I wanted to remind myself of who was who. But overall, it probably isn't everyone's cup of tea. I mean, if you're not into sort of that fiery, passionate sort of drama, if it's something a little more staid is what you're after.
Long show.
Don't bother. Yeah. But if you want to get your blood pressure up a little bit and you get the adrenaline flowing,
yes.
This is one heck of a ride. It really is.
It is. I mean, look, there's part of me that says they should have stopped after series two. Mm-hmm. After the first story, just stop. And then you would have sort of like frozen in amber, like I said before, possibly an absolutely perfect.
Yeah, it was very, very good. Yeah.
TV experience. It told a story. The story ended. And it's obvious that somebody in the production company went, well, we made a lot of money out of that one, didn't we?
Yes.
And they had to come up with a very, very convoluted reason for putting the band back together.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think, yes, they were reaching a little bit.
Yeah.
So it was the Royal Mint in the first season.
And yes, it was.
It's the bank Bank of Spain in the second season with all the gold.
Yes.
That after. Yeah, but I think that's true. The way they made it work in the end was, no matter how convoluted the story was, we still cared about the characters, and that's what eventually wins the day. But yes, you're right, the plotting was fairly involved and not necessarily as seamless as it could be. But
okay, well in that case, let's talk about the characters for a second, because we're gonna chew this to death. But the characters were what made it. And so you know, if you remember at the very, very start, we saw the backstories of all of them, like how the professor came to recruit them all, what made them tick. We knew about them. I wasn't completely convinced about the two new additions at the end of the first story. I thought there was one that her turning was a little bit too trite. I wasn't completely convinced about that. But I was so caught up with it that I was willing to go, okay, yeah, fair enough, I'll allow it. Yeah. But then, as the second story dragged on a little bit, the characters were developed, so now they just have to go and do stuff. But then they introduced too many new ones.
Yeah, there are a lot, and there's a lot of you've almost got to, as you're watching, just remind yourself, okay, that person has that relationship with that one, but also has a relationship with someone else that impinges on that one. So
yes,
there's a lot of cross-pollination of,
yes,
of character lines.
Yes.
But I guess if you're a band of people in the middle of a crisis, all this is going to spill out. They can't, yeah, maybe they do lose control of it, but maybe that's what would happen. I don't know. I've never been in a bank heist myself, so I can't quite.
It's been a while for me, to be fair. But I'm thinking about the writers who have, I think they've overdone it. So we know suddenly, you know, we've got Bogota and Palermo and Marseille and Helsinki and Manila. Yeah. And Manila's probably got the most complex backstory of all of them. But I'd forgotten what made Manila tick.
Yeah, yeah. I actually wrote down a whole bunch of the characters' names just here on my right, Stephen. I've left out Manila, for goodness sake. What was I thinking?
Even though the only one with a particularly fleshed out backstory, really, to be fair. Yeah. And then you've also got, let us not forget, a bunch of blokes downstairs in the basement smelting the gold who don't even have names.
Yes, yes. And then you've got the other band who are the outside in the police national headquarters of varying police and generals. And there's a lot happening. There is a lot happening, there's no doubt.
Colonel Tamayo and the rest.
Yes.
Yes, there's too much. It's one of the brilliant things about the very first story was, frankly, it was claustrophobic. Mm-hmm. It was, everything was very, very, very tight, and there's a pressure and tension, and that's what kept it going. Mm-hmm. Now, it's just bang, 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 and so many characters that you lose track of who's what and why we should care about them. And as a result, because they don't have the backstories, they're becoming caricatures.
I 100% agree with you on that. I think there are probably too many characters, and I think it is more challenging to follow that. I think, for example, the Tamayo who you just mentioned, who's the overall one leading the inside the tent, barking orders, and it's being, you know, it's always, you think he's the baddest of the bad. I think he is a caricature. Others perhaps not so. I just think the stakes are so high in the story, Steve.
Yeah.
As complicated as it can be, and as infused with flying bullets as it is, and flying expletives, I still want to know what's going to happen to these characters at the end. I still care about their life and their death. So on that basic sort of storytelling level, I'm buying it. I think you're right. I think the first season was absolutely outstanding. And if they had stopped right there, it would be just a gem, wouldn't it?
Yes, absolutely.
I just want to mention one thing quickly.
Go ahead. Please.
In a way, it's so simple, but it's also so clever.
Go on.
By choosing to name all these characters in the professor's band by cities around the world, isn't that a lovely way to gain an international audience?
Yes, it
You've
is, isn't it?
You've got cities in Africa, Asia, North and South America, Europe. That, unfortunately, there's no Sydney or Canberra or Wellington, but hey, we'll forgive them that. But, yep. You know, pretty much you've got, the world is covered. So I'm not, it's quite nice in a way. It's and the other thing I thought was really interesting that in the Spanish band, you do have, as you mentioned earlier, they're the two cousins, Helsinki and Oslo. Now, they're Serbian. They've got, and speaking very good Spanish. And I thought that was just an interesting, just a little touch of how Europe is cross-pollinated, to use that phrase again that I used earlier. Like, there were people are thrown in from different countries. They learn the language of the home country where they're growing up or whatever. They're migrants, perhaps, whatever it might be. I like that sensibility in the story that it. I can see why people around the world would have bought into it. Maybe they just, especially if you lived in Stockholm or Helsinki, Bogota, Marseille, Moscow, Denver, Nairobi, Rio, Lisbon, Berlin, Manila. You name it.
Okay, then I'm going to put you on the spot. What would your money heist name be?
Oh, well, the thing I, in Spanish, it's La Casa de Papel, which is the house of paper.
Yes.
And in a way, that's quite good because it's paper. It could be money, but it could be the paper of bureaucracy and corruption. It could be you can blow it down. I would have gone with something similar to that, I think.
No, but what I meant was, what's your city name?
Oh, sorry. Yes. I thought you were actually asking me a much deeper philosophical question.
No, I'm not that deep, Simon.
Well, we should go for something from outside part of the world. How about Tokoroa?
Okay, fair enough.
Throw that in.
Yeah, you'd certainly send people searching on a map for it, wouldn't you?
You would. Yeah, sounds a little bit like Tokyo to some people, perhaps, but...
And I don't think anyone's going to confuse you with Tokyo, to be absolutely fair.
There is that. And your good self? Are you not telling me you're going to be Manchester?
Oh, well, no, they did say at the very beginning, it can't be a city that you're from.
Ah, okay.
So that would rule Manchester out. Now, for family reasons, I would go with Dublin.
That's a good choice. Dublin. Yeah. Good international.
I know I caught you on the hop there, mate, but I have actually given that one some thought myself. Dublin or Pittsburgh.
Okay. Very good.
And why not?
Right, see, well, I have noted that we're an interesting area right now. Here we are in New Zealand and in Auckland, especially we're in level 4. The rest of the country may not be far away from going out to the cinema and perhaps watching some live music, and elsewhere around the world, people are going to the cinema. So there are movies coming out that some people around the world are watching. We can't see them yet here in New Zealand. Some big budget ones, another Marvel movie's just come out.
Yes.
There's a Shang-Chi. There's going to be, I see at the latest film festival in Vienna, which has just concluded. There's what looks like a very interesting adaptation of Dune, the Isaac Asimov classic. There's a whole bunch of films coming out. Maybe, Steve, it won't be too long, maybe a month or so before we can actually get out and see some of these at the theatre.
I would hope so. I did see the poster for Shang-Chi, The Legend of the Ten Rings, and it says opening on September the 16th, and then little letters underneath it says, excluding Auckland. We know we can't go and see. You don't need to rub our noses in it.
It's a break.
That's a bit much, really. Don't forget, we're also soon going to get Daniel Craig's last outing as James Bond.
Yes.
At last.
Yeah, we'll look forward to that. Steve, for people who have, just to wrap up our chat on Money Heist, if you have watched the first seasons up till now, are you saying to people, come on folks, just give it one more try, let's see it through to the end, or are you saying that don't bother?
I think, to be fair, if you've come this far, it would be a shame to give up at this point. It's not going to win any converts. It's definitely for the committed only at this stage, I think, but if you've been on board with it until now, why not? The professor's still there. He's still he's still absolutely bizarrely brilliant. And seriously, just do it.
No, I agree. I mean, yeah, it would be, gosh, imagine if you had not seen any of it and you just stumbled onto the season, you'd be scratching your head. You'd have to go back to the beginning.
But, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, I think it's, for all the reservations, and there are a few, it's still a heck of a ride, and just maybe give yourself one or two episodes to get into it again in this
late definitely, season. Yeah.
All guns blazing, and more than not just literally so. Anyway, great stuff. So, Steve, I put all these thoughts together in a written review, which is on our website, cravepodcast.com, where we have other reviews and other entertainment news. So it's a good spot to check out what Steve and I are up to, what we're following.
Absolutely. I'm going to be following up very shortly with a review of the new Aretha Franklin biopic, Respect. I'm going to have that review up in the next day or so.
Okay, fantastic. Reading
quick spoiler for you there.
I think I've read it somewhere. Yeah.
Well, that would be about right, to be fair, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, good when it's good.
Hmm.
But we'll let folk know as soon as the review goes up and they can read it themselves. Right. So if anyone's got any comments or any thoughts to share with us about any of this, how can they get in touch with us, Simon?
Well, I'm glad you asked. You can email us, podcast@cravepodcast.com. But that's not the only way you can get in touch.
Absolutely not. We're on Facebook, we're on Twitter, we're on Instagram, you name it, we're on it. Actually, except for TikTok, we're not there. But you can reach us any other way you want to. We are at Crave Podcast.
Fantastic. Okay, well, I hope you enjoyed our chat on Money Heist. We'll be back again soon with another expertly dissected piece of analysis.
Absolutely.
Piece of entertainment. But until next time, I'm Simon Mercer.
I'm Steve McCabe.
And that's what's been entertaining us this week.
Nice one, mate.
If I'm losing now, but I'm winning late, that's all I want. I don't care at all. My time.